Dr. Anandi Subramanian, Assistant Professor, Department of Preventive Oncology, Cancer Institute, Chennai. I welcome you, ma'am. I record my sincere welcome to our beloved Principal, Dr. R. Muralidharan, and our CEO and Secretary, Dr. R. Manikam, in their absence. Next, I extend my welcome to the Dean, Heads of the Department, faculty members, and students. Once again, I welcome you one and all for this session. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I request Dr. M. Rajalakshmi, Assistant Professor of our department, to introduce our chief guest.
Good morning, one and all present here. It's my pleasure for having an opportunity to introduce our guest speaker, Dr. Anandi Sivanjanam, Assistant Professor, Department of Preventive Oncology, Cancer Institute at Adyar, Chennai. To start with, she was a research associate at Department of Biotechnology, Indian Institute of Technology at Madras. She has also pursued her postdoctoral research at Department of Biotechnology, IIT Madras. She is an expert in molecular biology, diagnostic microbiology, and handled different kinds of human samples with different clinical conditions for biomarkers identifications. So far, she has published 20 articles in reputed peer-reviewed national and international journals and has been a member of professional bodies like SEMA Microbes, Proteome Society in India, ARVO USA, QFO Switzerland, and Asia Award Singapore. To her record, she has received notable awards like a Visiting Researcher Award from USARVO and Travel Fellowship Awards from ICMR and Asia ARVO at Hyderabad. Till now, she has received one project funds from DBT Biocare and has received postdoctoral funds from Indian Institute of Technology at Madras. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am, for that introduction. So we have such a renowned guest to deliver an apt topic for on the today's event. I hope it will be useful to all the participants. And the dais is over to you, please.
Thank you, one and all. Good morning to everyone. So shall I start giving my screen sharing?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it possible to all? Can anyone confirm? Is it possible?
Not yet, ma'am.
Okay. Is it now visible?
No, ma'am. It's visible now. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Just full screen and then.
Okay. Okay. So today I'm here to deliver a topic about a part of my research work, which I was doing with the DBT Biocare funding. So the major.
Ma'am, excuse me, please. Your voice is quite low, ma'am. Please increase your volume.
Is it better now?
A bit closer to the mic, ma'am.
Is it okay now, or I'll change the speaker?
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
So title will be to quantitative tongue tissue proteomics, specifically tongue cancer, for identifying novel biomarker discovery. So before stepping into the results part, I would like to give a brief intro about the oral squamous cell carcinoma. So the picture now I'm showing here is anatomy of the oral cavity, which gives all the part of your oral cavity, starting from lip, teeth, heart, rates of late and many other things which we are not much aware of also. But any oral cancer encompasses all the malignancies originating in the oral tissues, including all these parts. So this is the major thing. And when we come to the stages, we have about 5 different stages, starting from 0 to 4. Initially, we call them as a carcinoma in situ, that is an early form of the cancer. Then it moves towards localized form, and further to early locally advanced, and further to late locally advanced. Finally, metastasis. The major problem with this condition is mostly patients come to us only during the stage 3, that will be in late locally advanced stage. So during that stage, it is very difficult to treat the patients. I'll tell you in detail about that. When we look into the global scenario of this particular oral cancer, as we all know, it has a major health problem compared with other cancers. Especially in India, it is the most common cancer in males and third commonest cancer in females. And literatures and all these reports from WHO and other things predict that in 2030, we have a very much high increase of this incidence, especially with the lip and oral cavity cancers, both irrespective of sex. And what are the current challenges we face? So when we just took this topic for my research angle, the challenges what we are facing is mainly, as I mentioned earlier, the high prevalence is because of late diagnosis. They come to us at a very late stage. When it is going to be in late stage, treatment, therapeutic success has also been very less. We cannot expect everybody to behave in the same way. As well, even though we start giving treatments, the problem is the 5-year survival rate is very much less when compared to other cancers, especially with these or the oral cancers. We have multimodality therapy, we have many other advancements, though this particular cancer is still being a devastating disease in the recent decades. All the reports, all the research people, as well as the medical expertise, information was to deliver only one thing is detection of this oral cancer in a very early stage. That is the only effective way to make the patient survival in a better angle. Otherwise, diagnosis becoming late, always being a therapeutic success also is very less. To identify these things, so there is a need for biomarkers. So biomarkers is to help the identify the patient in a very high risk angle. And to detection of the patient in early stage, as well, to know the disease outcome. Though the patient come in the same stage, some will respond better for the treatment, some might not. So we need to have some markers which tell us whether the patient is responding to us or how the treatment is helping to him for a better survival. So for all these things, we need a biomarker for an emerging trend. For understanding to the student level, I just want to mention what is a biomarker. So biomarker is a molecule which helps us to diagnose the disease in a non-invasive way. It can be any molecule, say it is an organic or inorganic. It is a molecule which helps us to test the subject while the patient is the host to a biological process. It can be easily tested in the body fluids as well as in the tissues. With respect to cancer biomarkers, we always focus on these 4 points as a major way for identifying biomarker. As was mentioned earlier, we have to diagnose them in a very early stage. And to confirm a particular chronic disease, we need certain markers to tell us the information before starting the treatment. As well, once the treatment is getting started, we need to know how far this effectiveness is being happening in the particular individual. So for assess them also, we need biomarkers. As well, individual cases, as was mentioned earlier, each patient behaves differently, irrespective of the same category of stages, same category of treatment what they give, individual immune response is different. So we need to have biomarkers to tell the evaluation or prognosis of this particular cases. So I basically work with all protein biomarkers. Since from my 2004, after my master's from microbiology, I started this career with an proteomics expertise. And we are interested in protein markers. Why? Because we strongly believe that proteins are the closest region like which is being accessible to us in any disease condition than the parent genes. As well, these proteins are the key regulators for cellular function. If you see the literatures and the earlier all the identifications, mostly all the cancer biomarkers are proteins. As well, any drug target will be a protein molecule. So always protein markers are more reliable than the genetic markers. So when we tell this about the word called proteomics, it is not only a set of proteins, a set of isoforms, set of modifications happening in the proteins, interactions and other structural descriptions, all these were coming into the protein on the one name called proteomics thing. So when we come to the proteomics part of subject in a biomarker discovery, so we have four different phases. First one, to prepare the sample and fractionate them. You have to mix the complexity of any sample, say a tissue sample or a body fluid, you have to mix the complexity of the sample to a lighter level. And to separate the proteins in a broader way. And we have to profile them. So profiling helps you a lot, and then we can go for an identification purpose. So this identified markers can be used as a diagnostic way, therapeutic option, or for prognostic targets. This slide, I just want to mention a few markers which has been already available for different other cancers. When you look into, we could not find any specific marker for oral cancer yet. We are not been having any specific marker for oral cancer. That one major reason is oral cancer is a problem of Indian population, not the other Western populations. Whereas they have done all the major works with breast cancer, ovarian cancer, prostate cancers, different other cancers. And many markers are already in line, starting from BRCA gene for breast and ovarian. For prostate cancer, we have prostate-specific antigen, where still they use that as a screening marker. Whereas for responding therapy, people use KRAS mutation and anti-EGFR antibody for colorectal cancer. The point I want to highlight here is we don't have a marker for oral cancer yet. So these points made us to focus on more towards oral cancer biomarkers. When I look at the literature, okay, what is happening in oral cancer and what they have done earlier, very few reports were there just to identify the markers which were not further validated, which are not taken to any of the clinical sample level. Only they identified the markers within a number of, say, 5 to 10 samples, they just tried to identify. No further studies were taken further. This made me to see, look into the Indian context, what is happening in Indian context level. To the surprise, I couldn't find any article reporting about the marker identification in Indian population. We have reports, we have papers where they try to utilize the data which has been obtained from Western population and screen them in our population. So there were no study to identify the Indian population cancer-based markers, especially for the oral cancer, when we started this study. People might think, what is the big difference between a population based with respect to cancer? Cancer is going to be a cancer anywhere. But it is not like that. I want to highlight certain points here. Because people have done the research studies, even with the proteomics option, where they have compared population based samples, comparing Sri Lankan samples with the Sudan population. And they found the profile is completely getting different. So cancer is not same for our population and for the other things. The response is different. The response from the population differs from country to country. And even report says that comparing with whites and African Americans, these people have a higher option or higher incidence in getting these oral cancers. As well in Florida, they found that African Americans have a lower survival than the whites. These things do make you aware that we need population-based markers with the Indian context. To the emerging need, we need that. So this made us to point out the objectives very specifically with Indian population samples. We have all these prevalence very high. As we know, we have a major use of tobacco, alcohol, all the food habits and everything. And case-to-case variation is a major part with all the medical people to have a great success. So it is not same, as I was mentioning earlier also. So each and every patient have a different immune system profiling and different way of response to the treatment. So these all made me to profile the cancer tissue sample obtained from the Indian population. So with this, I made a simple objective to identify the markers using specifically advanced technique called 2D dyes. I'll tell in detail in the further slides. Not only identification of them using mass spectrometry, validating them in a different set of samples to know how far these identified proteins behave in the same way in a different category of peoples with having oral cancer within Indian population. So the total number of samples we have taken for this part of chapter is about 80, where we had 30 for discovery phase and 50 for validation phase. As I mentioned earlier, discovery phase, we have used proteomic approach, 2D dyes coupled with LC-MS-MS, is called liquid chromatography, mass spectrometry. On for validation phase, we use quantitative real-time PCR to know RNA level of transcription, what is happening for the same markers. So we had 30 in discovery phase, 15 in validation phase. We had about 30 of, this means same patient, we have taken the normal sample as well as the cancer sample, tissue samples. Whereas for validation phase, apart from normal people, that we have taken volunteers as well, and we have taken those samples also for testing the marker validation to tell them as a biomarker, we need to have more number of normal samples. So on the whole, we have taken 50 normals and 60 cancer samples. Age range we have kept from 27 to 80 years. When we compare about this male versus female, and we always have male patients to be the dominant thing, but still we have female patients as well, who don't have even any habits and things, but we will get the whole cancer in female patients as well. So we have taken their samples also for this very population. The approach what we have done is, I have done with both tongue as well as cheek tissue. For today's webinar topic, I'm giving the information only about the tongue samples due to time constraint. So after extracting, means we used to get the tissue samples during the surgery, and with this tissue samples, we extract the protein, we lyse them using sonication, and we optimize the specific axis markers specifically for cancer tissues. And then we do an SDS phage analysis to know the quality as well as the quantity of the protein what we have to find. And further, we take them to 2D electrophoresis where we separate the proteins, and then further we do for image analysis. 2D, to mention in a short way, is called two-dimensional electrophoresis, where proteins are getting separated based on two major properties. First with charge and then with the molecular weight. In SDS phage, we do only with the molecular weight, whereas in 2D, we have an additional separation step using the charge base. So based on this, we can make the profiling in a complete way. And the workflow starts from preparation, and we have a particular machine, isolytic focusing, where proteins will start migrating based on their charge property. And in isolytic point, where the protein is getting a null point of charge, it stops there. And then we take those strips, and then we follow with the second dimension with the molecular weight, and then we visualize them and compare versus normal versus cancer, how it behaves. Advanced method of 2D is called 2D dyes, which means 2D difference in gel electrophoresis. Here, the major advantage is that in 2D electrophoresis, we'll be having three samples, which will be having three gels. Say for three normal, we'll have three normal gels. And three cancer, we have three cancer gels. In this case, we can label the samples with different Cy3s. Like cyanine dyes, we have Cy3, Cy5, and Cy2. And this labeling helps us to have a very high sensitivity to pick up even less concentration of sample. So after labeling, we have an option of pooling all these things. So all these samples were pooled and given in one tube. So after mixing, all the sample will be in one tube, and this one tube of sample will go for one strip. So which means all your labeled samples going to run throughout along with the same gel. Having one gel, you'll be having both control sample labeled with Cy3, and you'll be having cancer samples labeled with Cy5. So the main advantage of this technique is we can avoid gel-to-gel variation. They will be knowing in the same gel, in the same location, how your protein spot is behaving in normal sample, how it is behaving in a cancer tissue. So this is an advanced method where you can avoid gel-to-gel variation, and minimal sample quantity is very much sufficient for having a full profiling. As you all know, we will not be getting a huge chunk of material from a cancer patient. We cannot be able to take that much tissues. So whichever tissues being excised during the surgery, that should be well enough to help us in profiling, the whole profiling. So after this, okay, how we are going to make it in three different images is, we have a dedicated scanner, which is being laser-based, which can differentiate with the particular nanometers. So we'll be able to scan them in different wavelength to get different images. So one gel will give you three different images, one with control, one with your cancer sample, and one is the internal standard, that is a control of the whole experiment thing. So based on these things, we'll be doing all the analysis for all the tumor and normal samples. So after analysis, we have dedicated software we use from GE Healthcare. So that is being patented with this company. and this module help us to compile all the samples, like if whatever number of samples you are running, say for 30 or 50, you can categorize them into your normal group and the cancer group, and it will help us to compile and give you statistical information with the fold change, the 3D view. It tells you same protein spot, how it behaves in your normal sample, how it is getting increased or decreased in the tumor sample. As well, it gives you based on the spot intensity, how it is getting differentially expressed. So after this comparison, we'll be excising the spots. So this will be like a gel thing. We'll take the spots, each and every spot is meant for a protein. So whichever is getting differentially expressed compared to your normal as well as the tumor sample, we'll excise the spot and we'll chop into pieces, and we have a 2 day procedure to convert this protein to a peptide, and we'll be injecting to a major machine called liquid chromatography mass spectrometry. And we have about a thermo machine where we will be applying all these peptides over there, and we run the mass spectrometry analysis completely for a day, and we'll be getting the spectrums and chromatograms. And we have inbuilt softwares which help you to know the protein name. So this way you can identify the protein from your own samples. Rather following the papers what they identified and checking the sample, we'll be able to identify our own markers, which might be a novel marker for our cases. This is the methodology we have employed for this project. This is a result slide just for representing. I have mentioned about one sample here. So this whole thing is with a different dye label and corresponding grayscale image I have mentioned here for better understanding. For this particular experiment, we have labeled the normal sample with sulfide and tumor sample with citrate. And region, whichever I have marked here, you can see how far it is getting differentially regulated. For the surprise, this is taken from the same patient with the tumor region and the corresponding normal tissues from the adjacent normals. And marked regions will tell you clearly how far this protein is getting differentially expressed. Each and every spot here is a protein. In SDH page, we'll be seeing as a band, whereas in 2D, we'll be seeing as a spot, as it is separated based on the charge first in this way and based on the monitor by this way. So each and every protein have a unique SLP point. So profiling is very best in this particular gel-based approach. So these were further compiled with the software, which I was mentioning earlier. And finally, we could identify a heat map with top 122 differentially regulated spots. We have stringent category of about 10 parameters, starting from 1,500 pair. We have multiple parameters to shortlist and filter these samples. And then we found 122 having a differential expression across normal versus tumor. So this heat map for your understanding, this minus one is for the green color, that's having a lower expression, and this maroon color having a higher upregulation. All these green circles marked here were taken from normal samples, and all this maroon color were taken from cancer samples. When you just see on the whole itself, each and every bar here represents one protein spot. All these normal pattern, which has been lowly expressed, are getting highly expressed when it becomes a tumor condition. All these proteins, which have been highly expressed in normal condition, during tumor is getting completely vice versa. So this way, you will be able to profile the complete scenario of the cancer samples, how it behaves when before and in normal tissue as well as in the cancer tissue. So after this analysis, we found that statistically, how much is getting differentially expressed. So we set a threshold of 1.5 fold increase, 1.5 fold decrease with the statistical significance. We could identify 31 upregulated proteins and 42 downregulated proteins. This table summarizes the average ratio of the individual spots, their appearance, their position, and the ANOVA value. All these were taken for mass spectrometry analysis. And in mass spectrometry analysis, successfully, we identified about 24 candidate markers which were being identified using Indian population cancer samples, especially tongue cancer samples. Among these 24, we have 8 proteins to be highly downregulated and other 16 proteins to be highly upregulated. So this table summarizes the average ratio of the individual proteins and the ANOVA value with the regulation status in tumor. So with these 24 markers, we want to take it further for the validation phase. Now we have identified the discovery phase, all these 24 markers, and we are moving on to validation phase for the next level of study. So So before going to the validation phase, this table tells you about the information of individual, all the uploaded proteins with the 3D information with the graphical representation. This is for the analysis part, how you can visually see the protein existence, how it behaves in a normal sample, how it is coming in the tumor sample. Same way we have done the analysis with down-regulated proteins. You can see exactly the how the pattern is, how it is going down-regulated across the samples and across the gels what you have used here. This particular sample, you can see this higher expression is seen in normal, where it is going to be very much lower in the tumor condition. That's for understanding and describing this here. So in the validation phase, we took all these 24 samples and 24 markers, and we have done with the quantitative real-time PCR analysis, where the tissue samples were taken, RNA was extracted, and cDNA conversion was made, and then we did all these analysis to know exactly how this trend matching with the proteomics data with the real-time data. Interestingly, most of the maximum all the 24 have a similar type of pattern which has been expressed across proteomics data as well as the real-time data. So these 24 markers we have taken further for gene ontology analysis. When we do the classification of these proteins, we found most of them were coming into cytoskeletal proteins. Because it has been tongue and other major tissue involvement is there, we have this actin myosin playing a major role here. When we do the pathway analysis, interestingly, we found not only cancer pathways are getting highlighted, we even get pathways like Parkinson's disease, other glycolysis also getting highlighted with all these 24 things, which means these 24 promising markers have a potential role not only with the cancer and with other disease process as well. To the closer view of this functional characterization, in molecular function level, we found major function to be catalytic activity, whereas in biological process, it involves everywhere, starting from developmental process, cellular process, biological regulation, response to stimulus, and everything is being highlighted by these 24 markers. Then we did an interaction analysis as well. Okay, how these proteins talk to each other, whether they have a link between among them during a cancer condition. And interestingly, we found the two major groups to be clustered in the interaction analysis. This all one green nodes represent the heat shock proteins, other inflammatory proteins coming in one group, and all the myosin and the actin-based proteins coming in the other group. MYL is being myosin light chain, TPM represents for tropomyosin, and CFL represents for coagulin, all these involved in the actin cytoskeleton regeneration process. Whereas, we still have certain players which were not linked with these 24, but still have other potential role in cancerogenesis process. So in detail, we found about 17 proteins which have involvement with the cell survival cascade, and we have 3 proteins impinging on the cell proliferative pathway, hemoglobin, beta unit, S100A7, and transferrin. And we have certain proteins which is already been reported to be a marker for resistance to chemotherapy, which makes them study valid, which contributing to the poor prognosis of especially tongue cancer. With respect to cytoskeletal remodeling, 7 proteins we found, which plays a major role in formation of stress fibers, cellularity, cytokinesis, and these are all major involvement with the invasion and metastasis of the tongue carcinoma. Specifically, we found many apoptotic and pro-apoptotic anti as well as pro-apoptotic proteins having a major role in the 24 markers. Evasion of apoptosis is a major hallmark of cancer, where it is the one majorly playing in the role we having in neoplastic progressions. And deregulation of these both pro and anti-apoptotic makes the cell survival to be in prolonged way, and how where it's getting escape from this apoptotic pathways. We found these 3 markers, which is being known as a very highly promising pro-apoptotic proteins, are getting down-regulated when we have a higher stage of cancer condition in lung cancer. As well as we have anti-apoptotic proteins, including serpin family, PSME, and thyroxine, having a highly advanced upregulation, which makes the cell survival in an easier way for the tumorigenesis process. As I was mentioning initially about this population specific, I was interested to know how far these markers are matching with the available database with Western population with different other cancers, respectively with oral cancer. So I have taken the database from BioExpress, compared the database and see like how it is matching. And we found 6 genes having a role which is being not matching with the data available from the Western population. This clearly tells us we need the markers which is being present with the Indian population. these six teams were having a different role in their population, whereas we have a different role in our own population. So this highlights the specificity of using the samples from our patients to identify the markers rather than using the markers which have been already established. So taken together, these analyses highlight the importance of biomarker-based population screening, which has the potential use in future therapeutic strategies for a better management of pancreases. To summarize, so this is the first study to do one tongue cancer profiling with respect to Indian population scenario using this 2D diet-based approach linked with marker chromatography. And we were the first one to report about 24 candidate markers from an Indian population setup, tongue cancer. Not only identification, we have taken for validation level as well, and we found a significant changes in real-time PCR as well. So these studies has a promising role. And now I have been having this study running with ELISA level. We are doing a salivary ELISA for all these markers. And that publication is said to be getting published. It's in a final stage. So I'm not showing the data now as of here. But we have taken this level 2 salivary samples, and we are going to use this as a screening markers in more number of patients. So these results have been already published in scientific reports recently. You can refer this, like you can read this article if you are interested in doing this proteomics analysis. And then you can reach me for any type of help or support for this part of study. Even for collaborations, we are interested. With this, I would acknowledge all the patients who were involved in this study, and especially my funding. It was a first PA grant for me, which made me to have an individual setup of experiments and projects of my dream. And I would mention here specifically, I was having a great support for proteomics aspect from a company called ThinBioCare Technology. It's been Chennai based. And this is Dr. T. Balashankar. I have put his number as well here. So they have been a new startup that they have all type of services available for proteomics, genomics, cell-based assays and everything. And students can make use of their workshops, webinars, and they have online hands-on training and hands-on training individual sessions as well. And they take internship and other things as well. So if there are any questions, I'll be happy to answer. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you, ma'am. That was a very in-depth study on oral cancer and their biomarkers. I just have a question for ma'am. What are the plausible outcome of these biomarkers, and how far they are reliable in providing early diagnosis?
That only we are into, as I mentioned earlier, these markers I have taken now to salivary samples. I am planning to use these markers, and with ELISA based or strip based method we are trying to establish. And we want to pick the patient in a very early stage, like how we are having this normal checkups, health screening. So we wanted to make a device like thing which will help the patients to catch them in a very early stage. That has been a long way process, but it is doable, and we are trying to achieve that.
Are there any other marker studies like this for other type of cancers?
Many type of cancers are already there. Not with the both same thing I was mentioning in the slide, where we have for prostate cancer, people are established, and PSA is the only marker for screening. And BRCA, we all know, they are using this for screening with breast cancer and things. Especially for oral cancer, we are not yet having any device or marker yet to be coming. So we are planning to achieve that in a very soon stage.
Participants, if you have any questions, you can ask the speaker. He has given an in-depth presentation on techniques related to identifying the biomarkers. She has also discussed about the 2D electrophoresis, which is an important technique in proteomics, and also a high-end technique in proteomics.
Good morning, ma'am.
Yeah.
In the first, thank you for this wonderful webinar. From this moment, I want to ask you one question to tongue cancer. That's what is the early sign and symptoms of tongue cancer?
The main thing is ulcer only, sir. You have an ulcer in your thing which is not getting healed for a long time. That is the first symptom that you can see. You should not ignore any type of those type of ulcers. That is the thing, it's slowly migrate and becoming a metastatic thing. That is the first symptom where you can see. you'll be getting a white spots in your tongue and slowly starting as an ulcer like thing.
What is the prognosis, ma'am, for as of now, chemotherapy is a mainstay treatment. How are there any new treatments for updated
people? Still, we are having same type of chemo. That is the problem we are having with especially the Indian scenario. So first, we will be analyzing the patient's health status and mainly economic status. So everybody cannot be affording for this chemotherapy. It will be quite expensive. So based on the whole thing, the treatment plans, we have different platforms been available. So based on that, medical persons will decide, okay, for the person, first we'll start radiation, or first we'll go for chemotherapy, based on the stage of infection, based on the mode of invasion, what they have. So everything matters before starting a treatment process.
Okay. Is there any questions to be discussed? Participants, please. They say no doubt. I hope they understood the session very well. So there aren't any doubt. Now I request Ms. Grishma, Assistant Professor of the Department of Microbiology, to deliver the vote of thanks. Ma'am, please.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, good morning, all. And it's my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks. And I, on behalf of Department of Microbiology, I thank all who are present here. And first of all, a big thank you to our chief guest, Dr. Anandi Shivatnyanam, Assistant Professor of Department of Preventive Oncology, Cancer Institute, Chennai, for delivering a lecture on quantitative tongue tissue for tongue carcinoma for biomarker discovery, which has a great hope in the field of oncology. And ma'am, you have very well explained the need and its methodology, ma'am. And thank you for your excellent presentation. And I might like to express our sincere thanks to our CEO, Dr. R. Manikim, for his constant. And I also wish to express my gratitude to Principal Dr. R. Muralidharan for providing guidance. And I must mention our deep sense of appreciation for Dr. P. Srinivasan, head of the Department of Microbiology, for organizing such a program. And I'm also very grateful to all my colleagues for their support throughout this event. And finally, I would like to take this opportunity to thank all the participants. And thank you all for your cooperation and participation. And once again, thank you all.
Thank you, Grishma ma'am, for your vote of thanks. And at this point, I would like to express our interest in collaborating with Anandi ma'am for doing the basic research on biomarkers. As of now, we are an academic sector, ma'am. So we have a basic microbiology laboratory established over here, and we have a UG course running here. But sooner, by this academic year, we will be starting medical laboratory technology and molecular diagnostic courses. So we hope that your inputs, I wish to invite you as one of the board members for suggesting inputs for framing the curriculum and syllabi, and also to support us in establishing the basic research in our institution, and also from also at your end. At this point, I would like to convey you the information. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for being here.
I'll be happy to do that. So much for you. Have my number and can be shared with students as well for anyone having any suggestions required. I can support them in all the aspects where I could reach you.
Sure.
Thank you very much for this opportunity to deliver my research part here. And I would especially thank Rajeshwari ma'am who contacted me for this webinar. So I'll be happy to be a part of any part of academic work for you, sir.
Oh, sure. Thank you. I will send you an invite for the Participants, thank you for your patient listening, and I hope you all had got at least a bit of information on cancer, because this is a big theme which has to be, which needs to be discussed then and there during your course of your study. So I hope at least you know now know what are the basics of cancer and few terms related to it, and we will take we'll be taking that to your heart. So the feedback form has been sent on the chat box. Kindly fill the feedback form, and upon submission, you will be receiving the certificate for participating in this event. Thank you all once again for joining the session. We will be having this platform open for another 5 minutes for you to fill the link. Thank you all. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. So, can I leave the session?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you.